We are still coming to understand the features and characteristics and traits of this virus that has upended the world. But there has been this open and ongoing question about how you catch it, right? I mean, we know that it's transmitted in all kinds of ways, but just how contagious is it? And people are wiping down their mail and their packages. They worry in the parks if people jog too close to them outside. And all of that might be vectors of transmission. It looks like it's possible, but increasingly, it seems the main method of transmission, the way it's mainly being transmitted, is saliva droplets spread through air being expelled by people with coughs and sneezes. NBC News correspondent Kerry Sander did this amazing segment breaking down what that looks like and how that works.
The engineering professors use a dummy to simulate the cough droplets we all create.
3, 2, 1.
The FAU team uses a laser to follow how far those droplets travel. What you're looking at is a mixture of water and glycerin that creates smoke 10 to 20 microns in size, the same size and weight of the smaller droplets of fluid we expel when we cough. The simulation shows the projection, 3 feet traveled in less than 2 seconds. Within 12 seconds.
That's at 6 feet.
And in 41 seconds.
There we go, 9 feet. And that was a cough, would you say?
That was a heavy, heavy cough.
In some tests, we saw the cough travel up to 12 feet. Increasingly, masks are commonplace. Remember, the use of a mask is to protect other people, not you. It doesn't stop at 100%, but you can see how it dissipates a cough.
Masks do appear to make a difference for precisely that reason in terms of you transmitting it. And this remarkable new study from South Korea shows how prolonged indoor exposure, people sitting in close quarters, right, sort of breathing the air around each other, is a main pathway for virus. This is from a call center in South Korea. Look at the map of people. All the blue chairs are people who got infected. And look how clustered together most of them are, just sitting right next to each other, working basically on top of each other. Joining me now to talk about what we know about coronavirus transmission is Dr. Angela Rasmussen, a virologist and associate research scientist at Columbia University's Mailman School of Public Health. So maybe start, Dr. Rasmussen, with a sort of overview about, like, what are the main vectors? Like, what do we think is the main thing that is transmitting the virus, the highest risk stuff? And then we can move towards the possible, but not the thing that's driving infection.
Sure, Chris. The primary mode of transmission for this virus is respiratory droplets, as you just stated. And that study from South Korea really demonstrates that. So you have a lot of people in one room getting infected while the other rooms on the same floor were not as affected. That suggests that this is not small particle aerosols that are hanging around in the air, circulating through the building and the air conditioning system. This is really transmission of those types of respiratory droplets, those larger particles, from people who are all in the same space together, sharing the same space. And we think that largely most of the transmission is driven by this method.
And that makes me, I mean, as we're sort of learning about this and thinking about what the world looks like, right, after lockdown, you know, it makes you think about subway cars and crowded buses. It makes you think about, you know, concert venues, certainly, but even big college lecture classes. Someone sits there for an hour and a half. I mean, it really sort of, to me, puts into focus workplaces where they don't have, you know, actual offices, all the places that look like they're probably going to be the most high risk. Is that fair?
That's very fair. I think one of the things that this study really underscores is how effective these physical distancing and stay home measures really are for reducing the spread of this illness. In an office environment, in crowds, like you just mentioned, all of those examples appear to be really good circumstances in which the virus can be transmitted to a variety of people.
The good news here, it seems to me, is what we're learning about outdoor transmission and sunlight and what the risks are if you're, say, outside in a park and people are jogging past and they jog closer than 6 feet, which happens. And it does seem, I mean, obviously people should stay far away, but it does seem that in general, like being outside and keeping your distance from people is pretty safe, all things considered.
I think so. I mean, the risk is not zero, certainly. Anytime you're exposed to another person's respiratory droplets, there is a measurable risk. However, what we've learned about sunlight, as well as all the other variables in the outdoor environment, so wind, humidity, temperature, that sort of thing, all of those can affect the amount of virus that you are exposed to. And if you're not exposed to enough virus to actually initiate an infection, you're likely to not be infected.
This gets to the surfaces question, and I know that some people, like, obviously in workplaces, like if we go back to that call center, those surfaces are close to each other. People are maybe sneezing on a keyboard, another person's using it. But surfaces of, say, packages, mail, things like that, I mean, again, the risk is not zero. I don't want to suggest that to anyone. But that seems further along the spectrum of low risk if we're sort of categorizing them. Is that fair?
I think that's very fair. It's really a matter of probability. So you have to think, what are the odds that your package handler is infected with coronavirus? They touch it. They're not touching their hands all over the entire package. They're touching one part of it. So what are the odds that you're going to touch that exact same spot, get enough virus onto your hand to establish an infection, then touch your nose in an amount of time that that virus is still going to be infectious? Those odds are fairly good in terms of you not getting infected. So I think that touching packages, touching groceries, things like that are relatively low risk activities, particularly when coupled with good hand hygiene.
Yeah, I mean, it really makes you think. I mean, I think that part of it, the outdoor stuff, the packages stuff is sort of like anxiety reducing. But when you try to think about like how a business that has a huge bullpen that looks like that one in the call center is going to safely bring everyone back, that is a real head scratcher. Dr. Angela Rasmussen, thank you for sharing your expertise tonight. I really appreciate it.
My pleasure.